All right. Well, good evening to everybody. I want to welcome you all here to this space, to this place with us tonight for our February Benedictine Conversation with our special guest, Father James Martin. I'm Dawn Carrillo, and I am the director of the Spirituality Center, the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of Saint Scholastica here in beautiful and chilly Duluth, Minnesota. The wind is howling out there. So we are co-sponsoring this event tonight between our center and the Bregelmann Program in Catholic Studies at the College of Saint Scholastica. And so I want to welcome my colleague and friend, Dr. Kevin Vaughn, as our co-host. Kevin is the director of the Bregelmann Program. So, Kevin, welcome. Welcome to you.
Thank you, Don. Thanks for having me.
Yes. Tonight, we are going to be starting our evening with a conversation between Kevin and me with Father Jim. And I'm going to introduce Father Jim in just a minute. And so further on in the conversation, I will tell you when you can start sending things in by chat. If you have a question, if you have a comment for Father Jim, feel free to send something in before that. If you don't want to wait until I formally say it's time to be sending things in, we'll take your question anytime. And I think the best way that we can begin tonight is with some of Father Jim's words from this beautiful book that we're talking about tonight called Learning to Pray. It is his most recent book that he has written. And a lot of parts in this beautiful book, thank you, Kevin, a lot of parts in this lovely book feel to me like prayer. So I want to start with some words from one of the first chapters there. He writes, "Your desire for prayer reveals something about how God created you. Deep within you is a natural desire to communicate with God, to share yourself with God, to have God hear your voice. Prayer reminds us of our need for God. It reminds us that we are not the center of the universe and that we are not God. Sometimes when things are going well, we can grow arrogant and complacent in our self-sufficiency. Prayer, which places us in the presence of God in an intentional way, reminds us of who is in charge, or rather, who is nurturing us. Not praying, not spending intentional time with God means your spiritual life will be out of shape, even flabby. And that will influence the rest of your life. You'll probably be less grateful and thus more irritable, less connected to the deepest part of yourself and thus more scattered, less aware of your reliance on God and thus more frightened. Prayer helps you." Father James Martin wears many hats, I'm aware. He's a Jesuit brother, a priest, the editor at large of America magazine, consultor to the Vatican's Dicastery for Communication, prolific writer, son, uncle, brother, etc. He's the author of many books, some of my favorite reading, I have to say. And like I said earlier, he's most recently written this beautiful book, Learning to Pray, which is the title for tonight's conversation. So, Father Jim, welcome. Thank you so much for being here with us.
Thank you so much, Dawn, and thanks to Dawn and Kevin and Jane too for arranging all this. Thanks to the center and the college. I'm just really happy to be here. And boy, you read that so beautifully. I was thinking, boy, those are beautiful words. I wonder who wrote them. And I think part of it is hearing you read that so beautifully and with such feeling. So thanks very much for starting off with that.
I thought that was a good way to segue into my first question. You speak in there so eloquently about prayer, about our desire for prayer and what some of the things that prayer does for us. So I'm wondering if we can start, I want to hear how you define prayer. What is prayer?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I go through a lot of definitions in the book. I look at St. John Damascene, who says prayer is a raising of the mind and heart to God, you know, which is good. Thérèse of Lisieux, it's a surge of the heart. Teresa of Avila, mutual conversation. Walter Burkhardt says it's a long, loving look at the real. For me, Bill Barry's insight, Father Bill Barry's insight that it's a personal relationship has been very meaningful. But in the end, the definition that I find is the most helpful is it's a conscious conversation with God. And, you know, that doesn't mean hearing voices or seeing visions, but also, but being aware of God's voice in your life, your daily life, and in your prayer. But it's a two-way street. It's a conversation. So that's the definition that I like.
Yeah. And I remember you saying in the book something about when I'm working all day, is that prayer? So that notion of praying unceasingly, what do you have to say about that?
Well, I'm smiling because that's, as you know, it's kind of a two-edged sword. There's an old saw, and I'm sure you both know this in religious life, my work is my prayer. Right now, on the one hand, that can be very beautiful, that if you are approaching all of your work and whatever that is, I mean, if you're a mother or a teacher or a father, an attorney or whatever, or work in a retreat house, if you're approaching your daily life and your work, your ministry as prayer, that's beautiful. But if you say, I work very prayerfully so I don't have to spend time praying, then that's a problem, right? I often talk about it in terms of relationship. That's Bill Barry's great model. And if you think about it in terms of relationship, you know, at some point you need intentional one-on-one time. It would be like saying, I'm sure there's a lot of people who are married on this call, like, oh, my wife and I, or my husband and I never have to talk one-on-one because we're together all the time. And you'd say, well, that, you know what I mean? So my work is my prayer is kind of a two-edged sword. It's something to be careful about.
Careful in terms of the intentional piece.
Yeah, careful. That it's an intentional thing if you're trying to work in a prayerful way. But I think even more challenging is if you say my work is my prayer and therefore I don't have to sit down and do any intentional prayer. It kind of like excuses everything. Like that's what a lot of Jesuits say. Oh, I don't have time for prayer. My work is my prayer. It's like, well, you know, at some point you'd have to sit down with God for some one-on-one time. Just like a couple at some point does have to sit and talk with each other. It just can't be kind of passing each other and doing dishes and errands and taking care of the kids. It does have to be some one-on-one time. So
yeah, or you can end up in trouble. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, one thing I'm curious about, you said early on in the book that you've been studying prayer for 30 years, which is wonderful. So I'm curious, so what prompted the book now?
Yeah, that's a good question. I've never been asked it that way. You know, why did it take so long in a sense? I wrote a book called The Jesuit Guide to Almost Everything, which was about Jesuit or Ignatian spirituality. By the way, I want to thank more broadly the Benedictine community of Duluth and the sisters and everyone who's part of that family as well for welcoming me. I wanted to do a book on Jesuit or Ignatian spirituality. And I touched on prayer a little bit in that book, but I didn't have space to really talk about what I wanted to talk about. And the heart of the book for me is the chapter on what happens when you pray. And I really did want to spend a lot of time on something that I think is totally mystifying to people. And I wanted to kind of, I felt it was I was ready to sort of tackle that and say, like, let's try to make it a little less mysterious and confusing and even frightening for people.
Yeah, because it seemed as I was reading through the book, you'd been collecting wisdom through the years and that it was just time to write it. Yeah.
It felt like that, yeah.
Yeah, very nice. Very nice.
If I can jump in here, Father Jim, you know, it's funny, you mentioned how prayer is often mystifying to people. And yet, in the very title of the work, your scope is really wide. I mean, you say this is for everybody, right, which is, you know, really quite remarkable. And you know, I'm thinking like, wow, I mean, you do qualify that a little bit, I think. But I'm just kind of curious, like, do you really think prayer is for everyone? Like, what about those people who might think, you know, I'm not a religious sister or brother, you know, I'm just kind of a regular person. Am I really supposed to get into something like Ignatian examine and, you know, discernment of spirits and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, I do think that. And I think, you know, I always say, look, when I entered the Jesuits at 27, I didn't know anything about prayer and I was just this regular guy. I still am a regular guy. And if I think the first line of the book is everyone can pray. And I think the second line is if I can do it, you can do it. but I think, you know, more fundamentally, we all have a desire for prayer. So look, we have 83 people here on this wonderful Zoom call. And there's something in each of these 83 people who are curious about prayer. There's a desire for it. Even if you feel like I'm not good at it. I don't know how to do it really. I get frustrated. There's a desire for prayer within you. And the question we have to ask is, where does that desire come from? That desire comes from God, who wants to be in relationship with everyone. And so the desire for prayer is God's desire for you. This is the way that, how else would God awaken in you, sure, the desire for prayer? And so, you know, it's funny. I saw this quote just today in the New York Times. I quoted in my book, and I guess it's Rumi, the Sufi poet, who said, that which you seek is seeking you. And so that's one way that we know that we have the desire for prayer. We're curious about it. We want to kind of enter into it. We want to live a spiritual life. We're curious about prayer. And that's the way God has of drawing us. And I really do think that's everyone. Whether or not people say yes to it is up to them.
It also reminds me of, I think it's the opening of the Confessions by Augustine, you know, where he talks about this restless heart and how, you know, God is the one stirring our hearts, you know, to be restless for God. And it's really quite remarkable. And I think you do a really great job at the beginning of the book, just showing all those different ways that your heart can be, you know, woken up a bit, you know, all these different ways. And that image of a relationship is really helpful, I find, as the book goes on, to kind of, you know, give a sort of context for how does that work, you know, and what does that look like? And so, you know, I have a question about that relationship, that relational aspect, because it is so dominant and so important to your book. When you're, do you have like a particular kind of relationship in mind? Like you mentioned that there are a lot of married couples out here, you know, watching this. I'm sure that's true. But do you mean relationship in a broader sense than that? Or do you have like a specific image of relationship in mind?
That's such a great question. I would say a very deep friendship. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not married, so I can't speak to that. But and maybe it's spousal for some people. But this idea comes from Bill Barry. And mm-hmm. I think it was really liberating for me. It was in his book, another great book called God and You. Mm-hmm. And he said that we can compare a relationship with God to a friendship. And, you know, it's not the perfect analogy. The idea would be, you know, all the things that make for a good friendship make for a good relationship with God. So, for example, honesty, right? What happens when you're not honest in a friendship? It gets kind of cold and distant and formal. Same with God. Listening, right? Now, we can talk about that later. I don't mean hearing voices or seeing visions, right, but, you know, listening to emotions and insights and thoughts that come up in prayer, as well as listening to God in your daily life. Listening is important. What kind of relationship would it be as if all you did was talk, right? Time, you know, you need to spend time with people to get to know them the same way. So Bill Barry's insight is that these same qualities that make up a good friendship make up a good relationship with God. And I often find that if people are struggling with their relationship, thinking about it in terms with God or their prayer, thinking about it in terms of a friendship can really help them. So one of the most common situations or experiences is when someone says, like, I feel God's distant, you know, and sometimes you say, well, all right, why is that? Well, maybe there's something that's they're blocking. They're not allowing themselves to talk about with God, disappointment or anger, or quite simply, they're not spending any time with God. You know, one of my favorite lines, I quote Richard Leonard, an Australian Jesuit, who says, which I love, it's a little provocative, but he is too, if God feels distant, guess who moved? So the personal relationship can help us kind of diagnose where our prayer life is, I think.
Sure.
Well, and you make a point in the book of saying that too many of us believe that that relationship depends on us, when we know that God is always initiating. And yeah, so we are the ones that move. You know, could you speak a little bit, Father Barry, I love his book, Praying with Our Emotions?
Yeah.
And just a beautiful way to speak about all those things that we're feeling, that so many times we say, well, God knows how I feel. But he encourages people, speak your feelings, tell God, have this conversation. And I'm aware from spiritual direction training in graduate school, the Ignatian contribution to spiritual direction, and you know, the emotions, the desires, feelings, imagination. And I'm very taken with the imagination piece. And so I'm just wondering if you could speak to that a little bit, because so many times in our enlightened world, we don't trust our imagination. We don't trust our feelings.
Yeah, I think you're right. And I think in terms of the imagination, when I was first introduced to what's called Ignatian contemplation, which is using your, you know, imagining yourself usually in a scripture scene or talking to God.
Yeah.
I thought, what is that? That's ridiculous. You like make stuff up in your head. And so what? Like, what? I'm just going to make things up. And yeah, my spiritual director said, no, I mean, you know, can you accept that God can work through your imagination? And it's a way of using the imagination to place yourself most usually in a scripture scene and to see what kind of comes up and what you notice, right? Mm-hmm. That's an important word in spirituality.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a lot of people, Some people like it more than others, and I'm sure both of you have run across people who say, oh, I don't have an imagination, I can't do that. But Bill Barry said, I love this line, I think I put it in my book, he said, if ever anyone's described hitting their hand with a hammer and you kind of wince, you have an imagination. And in fact, you know, when Jesus tells the parables, you know, a man was going to Jericho and he's telling a story and we're imagining these things. So it's using that gift from God, you know, to experience God. But again, it's not for everybody, meaning I think everyone can do it, but some people like it more than others. For me, that's one of the prime ways that I pray.
Mm-hmm.
Father Jim, I always love that, that line from the Gospels where Jesus says, who would give a snake to a child when they ask for bread? You know, and as a parent, I think, oh, that always made me cringe just thinking that idea.
Well, again, if you're imagining that, like, here's a snake.
and actually, if I can just sort of follow up on this, imagination is hugely important in many of the different kinds of prayer that you outline. And let me, you know, tell our viewers, there's a lot of stuff in here, like, you know, a lot of things outlined and described, and it's really great. But the one thing I wanted to ask you, because I don't think I saw it mentioned here, I'm just kind of curious to see what you think about this. When it comes to the imagination, if the imagination is so important, which I think it is, what about praying with art, literature, music? Does this have any place in a proper prayer life?
It does. I wish I put that in there, frankly, now that you're telling me. One of the things about these lectures and conversations, I'm like, oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know, I think, you know, praying with icons, praying with art, praying with literature, you know, I should have put that in there. What you were talking about, Dawn, you know, Visio Divina, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And praying with, absolutely. And I guess the thing I would say would be that, you know, different people pray in different ways, and God meets us where we are, and God encounters us where we are. And if so, for example, someone might want to sit in front of a beautiful painting or just look at a painting on their phone or an icon or something, and that's a kind of entree for them into a kind of contemplative stance, you know, it calms them down. Or literature, whereas it might leave someone else cold. So absolutely. I mean, I think it depends on who you are and what your personality is. I think the key is, you know, unfortunately for a lot of Catholics, it's like, oh, no, that's wrong, or that's better,
yeah.
Or, oh, that's not a real, I hear that a lot, that's not a real icon. You can't pray with that. And it's like, well, if you like it and if it draws you closer to God, it's a good way to pray.
Right. Huh.
Again, there's only so much you can get in a book, right?
No, I know, but I should actually, it's funny. It is true. I'm like, oh, I should have put that in there. But yeah, like one thing I didn't even consider, you know, is like literature. You know, what happens when you're reading a book that's really, particularly novel, that's really, or even a biography that's really powerful and that moves you to prayer, that makes you feel this kind of sense of a desire to be like this person, or, you know, I mean, I'll tell you something, you know, with myself, I usually do this every year. I usually read A Christmas Carol every Christmas by Dickens. And I just, it's very prayerful. I mean, you know, there's so many different movies and it's been used, but the book is quite beautiful and quite moving. And that's an entree into prayer for me every Christmas.
Right. So I'm curious now, we've talked about, and I'm thinking as you're talking about praying with art, praying with literature, it's almost like a way of doing lectio. And I think about the examen. And I think about how that is almost a lectio on my life for today, you know, just a little bit in there, right? Where we're thinking about new ways of seeing, new ways of understanding. So my question for you is, you know, you're a Jesuit and you are here speaking to this Benedictine community and whoever else is here. And I'm curious what you would say about the role of the Benedictines in your understanding of prayer.
I think, well, first of all, thank you for that lectio on your life. That's really beautiful. I'm gonna steal that and quote you. It is the examen is, that is what the examen is.
Yeah.
You know, I think part of it is I know so many Benedictines and I know, you know, the different monasteries and foundations. Now, this is a kind of subjective thing. I find that that the Ignatian spirituality, which uses the imagination and is emphasizes discernment, can be very, I mean, I'm saying this as a Jesuit, very analytical.
Yes.
And I think the Benedictine spirituality, somewhat like Franciscan spirituality, but in a different way, you know, is much more, as I see it, you know, much more open to things like beauty and nature and quiet. And it's not as, you know, I think the monastic tradition, you know, in the Benedictines just has made it a little more gentle, if that makes sense. I mean, it's a subjective thing, but I feel that when I'm with Benedictine men, but especially women, Benedictine sisters, there's a kind of gentleness and a quietness. And and again, I think that emphasis on hospitality, bringing the guest in, I think pervades the spirituality. And it's very hard to, I was thinking about this because spoiler alert, you sent me some of these questions earlier. And I was thinking, it's very hard for me to put into words. It's almost like describing a friend. To try to like, but it's basically, it's beauty, quiet, hospitality, but it's a gentler, less analytic, less kind of discerning. I've often said that if you gave St. Ignatius a flower, he would say, oh, what does this mean? You know, if you gave St. Benedict a flower, he'd say like, oh, this is really beautiful. Thank you. that's just a different it's, I don't know, how would you describe Benedictine spirituality?
Yeah, so I would describe it using many of the terms you did, that it's the listening, the slow discernment, and kind of a consensual sort of discernment.
Yeah.
And a real emphasis on finding God in the ordinary.
Sure. And do you think that comes from the monastic background?
I'm not sure. What do you think, Kevin?
I think it certainly does. And, you know, as you probably are aware, well, both of you are aware that, you know, when it comes to the Benedictines, each house has its own culture. You know, there is that overarching Benedictine community and charism, but each house has its own culture. And what I find fascinating about the Benedictines here is that there's also this great deal of action. You know, and you talk about this, Father Jim, in your book, you know, in connection to Lectio Divina, and where, you know, it ends with not just having a warm, fuzzy feeling, but it's about preparing to go out and to be disciples and to do that. And you look around the city of Duluth and you see all these institutions that these sisters have built, you know, it is like remarkable. And so there's a kind of like, it's this weird sort of back and forth. Well, it's ora et labora, right? I mean, it's that let's fill ourselves up with this, with the beauty and the grace of God, but then share that with the rest of the world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think you both put your finger on it. I mean, obviously, because you're much closer to the spirituality than I am, but there's a quality in it that is also, I find it, you know, you're talking about the slow discernment. I find it very unhurried. I mean, not every Benedictine is like this, you know, man or woman. Unhurried, centered, calm, but you're right, also a going out, which, you know, and they're just, yeah. So it's almost like describing like another country, like visiting another country, what the people are like. And it's a certain culture that I just love. And I find that it's, again, it's less kind of analytical and hard, you might say, like as the Jesuits, they're very like, it's always like, what does this mean? And what are we discerning? And where do we go next? And what are our priorities? Which is good, and you need that, but you need a little bit of kind of quiet and rest and communal discernment, as you were saying. So I think Benedictines have a better idea of ora and labora than Jesuits do, to be honest.
You know, Father Jim, I'm just really happy that in response to Don's question, you didn't bring up the Benedictine maledictions from the Middle Ages.
Which is in my book.
That is in your book. Exactly. There's a lot in this book. But more seriously though, you know, I guess you can sort of see where something like centering prayer could really come out of a Benedictine context, you know, and really grow and flower. And I know that Don, you can speak more to this, that we hear that there are centering prayer has had a seat within the community here.
Within the Benedictine community?
Yeah.
Yes, it has. And there's, right. Yeah, we have had a couple of groups going on for quite some time. Yeah.
I also think, frankly, there's a little bit more freedom in the Benedictine communities because, as you were saying, Kevin, they are a little more autonomous. And I've talked to Benedictines about this, and you know, if you have an abbot or a prioress, or you know, they're a little more autonomous than in the Jesuits, where everything is top down. And so, one of the benefits is, I mean, this doesn't characterize every monastery, every community. They're a little more free with things in a good way, right? And you know, the Jesuits would be like, you need to get the approval of the provincial, of your superior, and then the provincial, then Father General, and it's very. There's a reason why they call us, you know, a military order. It's Ignatius liked everything, whereas it's much more, I think, in a good way. I mean, it's much more autonomous. And so there's a lot more freedom. And so
individual freedom, talking.
So I think that influences the spirituality, which makes it a little bit more sometimes welcoming.
Or
you can experiment more, you know? But
that's interesting.
Kevin, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. Go ahead.
No, I just said that's very, very interesting what you've been saying. Yeah.
You know, and Kevin, your point about each community being different, they're much different than like Jesuit communities would be, because they, you know, It just is different kind of charism too, you know. St. Benedict's charism was different than St. Ignatius's.
Mm-hmm. So. Right. I have a chat message that came in from Patrice, and she says, for a simple lay person, I see the difference this way. Benedictine is more communal and Ignatian spirituality is more individual.
I think that's right. I think that's right. I mean, I do live in a religious community and we do communal discernment, but I think that's accurate.
Okay.
And I think because I think as I think, I mean, I'm not the, you guys are the expert, as a result of the monastic tradition, right? And they're being more focused on community than we are. They are. There is more of a sense on community. We had a, you know, in sort of, this is maybe too much in the weeds, but, you know, for a lot of Jesuits, I think growing up, including myself, it was community nourishes you in order that you can go out and work in the apostolate or in the ministry.
Okay.
That's very different for the Benedictines, where community itself is an end. And now we changed a lot and we've looked at that, you know, more carefully, but that's always been the case in Benedictine life. And I'd say to a certain extent, you know, more monastic like Trappist life and maybe even Franciscans. But for the Jesuits, it's no, the community, you know, it's like you fill up with your gas station, then you go out and you do your the real work. So it's just it's a different way of living.
Yeah.
It is.
Yeah. Well, I'm kind of curious. We were talking a second ago about different kinds of prayer, and Kevin mentioned centering prayer and so forth. Would you say that, what kind of prayer is off limits?
I would say anything that gets you to be in relationship with God is fine. There's no right or wrong way to pray. I think, you know, the only thing Kevin brought up, the Benedictine maledictions, which is the tradition I talk about, you know, cursing your enemies. Funny enough, I heard that on NPR this weekend. They were talking about enemies, and I don't know if you heard that, but
I didn't.
Where's this coming from? But, you know, I think anything that's, you know, if you're asking for something bad, like I want my neighbor's house to burn to the ground, or I want whatever, that's not a good prayer. But any other sort of form of prayer, you know, we've talked already about centering prayer, about Ignatian contemplation, we've talked about art, the examine you mentioned, Dawn. Any of those kinds of prayer are great if it brings you in contact with God. And I think that the difficulty for a lot of Catholics is that they've been told this prayer or that prayer is better or worse than another prayer. I'll tell you a funny story I talk about in my book. And it was told to me by two people. I think it's Bill Barry's original story, though. He had come back from a spirituality conference and was talking to his mother. And she talked about her rosary. And he said, which, you know, I pray the rosary, and a lot of people pray the rosary. And he said, oh, well, let me tell you a kind of a higher form of prayer. And she said, well, I like praying the rosary. And he says, well, that's nice, but, you know, a little, he told the story to himself, you know, kind of, you know, putting down the rosary a bit. And he said, what happens when you pray the rosary, Mom? And she said, when I pray the rosary, God looks at me and I look at God. And he realized he had this, you know, he had misunderstood it, and she had this very deep relationship thanks to the rosary. And so I think it's very, you know, we should never say, like, that's not a good way to pray, or you're praying it wrong. You know, people come to me and they say, I think I'm praying this wrong. I said, well, look, you might be praying it in a different way. Let's look at how you're praying it, but it shouldn't be this kind of lockstep thing.
In connection to that, I really like the section in the book where you were talking about rote prayer. And I have to say, I found it really surprising. I thought, well, you know, this is a learned text on prayer. You know, you give a rather vigorous defense of rote prayer.
Yeah. Like, yeah. I mean, I think that example, that story always comes to mind. Mm-hmm. You know, the person said the rosary is a rote prayer, and by rote prayer, we standardize formal prayers, the Hail Mary, the Our Father. You know, for one thing, Jesus taught the Our Father, so we can't denigrate it. Second, you know, it's prayers that are familiar to people, and they remind some of their childhood. And I don't mean that they're childish by any stretch of the imagination. And frankly, I think that a lot of these rote prayers, like the Memorare or the Hail Mary, the Our Father, they express what probably better than we could ever come up with in a million years on our own. Mm-hmm. But I think, I think by the same token, if you're only doing rote prayers, the book says, can you be open to trying new things? Yeah. I do think that, you know, Dawn, you were talking about maybe the only bad prayer is a prayer that you say, I don't need any other prayers for my entire life. You know, I'm never going to. And to use the relationship model, which I find is really helpful here, think about, like, let's say Dawn and Kevin and I went out every week and we got to become friends. And we had this tradition where we went out to dinner every Friday night and we had a great time. We caught up and blah, blah, blah. And we did a little face sharing now, which is great. Now, the two things, so think about that as a kind of prayer, like imagine that as like an analog for the rosary or something. Mm-hmm. Now, the two things that are bad, if you said, we will never do anything different. Like, would you like to go to a ball game? No, because we meet every Friday night at 6 o'clock for 2 hours. Or when you go out to dinner, you say, hey, instead of like going over everybody's schedule, like what happened this week, let's just tell a funny story. No, we don't do that. It's like, whoa, like what kind of relationship is that? And then worse, if you said to someone, the only way to relate to people is going out to dinner with them every Friday night. That's the only way. It's like, well, I don't see my friends like that. I do. Oh, no. So that's what happens. We get in a rut. We say, this is the only way to relate to God, if you think about that as a relationship. And then we say about other people, like, no, that's the wrong way to do it. This is the way to do prayer. And I mean, in Catholics is, if you're not doing the rosary, you're a bad Catholic. If you're not doing adoration, you're a bad Catholic. Or if you are doing this, you're a good Catholic.
Right.
And it really does a number on people. And then people get really, they feel like, oh, I guess I'm doing something wrong. So it's I think also flexibility and openness to new kinds of prayer is really important.
Yeah. Yes, I agree. You know, there's one thing I was going to ask you a little bit ago. When we talk about our deep desire for prayer, right, that it's instilled in us to be in relationship with God, and Augustine's famous line, our hearts are restless until they rest in thee, O Lord. What are your thoughts on why then is it so difficult? Why is it so difficult to be in relationship with God? People can live their whole lives without that kind of awareness.
Yeah.
What do you have to say about that?
That's a great, you know, I've never been asked that question. That's a great question. If we're made for God and God wants to be in relationship with us, why is it so hard?
Yeah.
And it is amazing. Like sometimes I sit down, I'm in my room now. I sit down in my chair to pray and I'm like, oh, I'm open up to God and I'm a Jesuit. I've been doing this for 30 years and it's still hard. The answer to that question is, I don't know. And I sometimes wonder, why doesn't God kind of give us much more grace to get through the day? Maybe God is, but we're not aware of it. You know, the only thing I can say, Dawn, is probably our humanity.
Yeah.
It's probably our ego gets in the way of things, our distractions get in the way of things, our need to control things. But it isn't, I think it's a really good question. And I sometimes want to go up to, when I get to heaven, if I get to heaven, and say to God, well, like, what about all those weeks that were so dry? Like, or how come when I asked for your help and whatever, I didn't feel anything? But then, Dawn, that's a great question. I think one of the great things, and I'm happy you brought it up, I think one of the things to admit for people is that sometimes prayer is dry. Mm-hmm. And you know, you might ask the same question about a marriage. Boy, if we're in love with each other and we said we're going to vow to one another, why is it sometimes hard? You know, and it's kind of human nature. But we do have to say that sometimes prayer is dry. And it doesn't mean, I'm so glad you brought this up, it doesn't mean that we're doing something wrong. It doesn't mean that God has withdrawn God's grace from us. It doesn't mean that God hates us or God's abandoned us. And it also doesn't mean that we're not made for prayer. It just means that from time to time, prayer is dry. And you're right. And that relationship, I've never heard a quote put so well, you know, it can be hard. But it is a great philosophical question. If God wants to be in relationship with us and we want a relationship with God, what's the problem? I guess it's our humanity in the end.
I have another tough question for you from Michael. And I would like to extend an invitation to the viewers now to remind you to go ahead and start sending in questions. I've got a few here. Michael says, and this is a challenge, can you suggest how we can pray for those who have different political views? It is difficult to pray for X person, let's just say.
Yeah, I think, you know, part of it is asking, one of the prayers I like is to ask God to see them the way God does. That's usually a prayer I find that's answered. I also think if it's an individual, if we're talking about some group or some political figure, it might be hard because we don't know them, but you can always pray if you think a person is, you know, being cruel or something, or you can pray for a conversion, right? But I really do think asking God to see them the way God does helps. I sometimes find very helpful asking to see them in the context of their family. I find that very helpful. Like this is a person who has whatever, a family, kids, mother, father, and I do find that's helpful to see them as like a full human being. But you know, I mean, if the you know worst comes to worst, to pray in a sense for their softening of their heart, right? You know, that's that like the old Irish prayer, like I don't know if you can quote it. It's something like, God, please turn their minds, and if you can't turn their minds, turn their ankles. You know, right. Something like that.
So I'll know them by their limp or something.
Yeah, that's right. Right. But no, I think, and you know, we have to do it. Look, Jesus, sometimes people see it's like a pie in the sky, but Jesus asks us to literally says, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. And it's a kind of softening too. I think if you can't do that, then at least don't wish them ill. Like if you have a hard time actually praying for them, at least don't wish them ill, you know, and pray against them. Because it does kind of warp you a little bit.
One of the things that I've done is I have, you know, intentionally said to myself, now, Dawn, you need to remember that God loves that person as much as God loves you, Dawn.
Yeah. You know. Well, and then the other thing is, you know, one of my favorite insights, and I don't know who said it first, it's like a bumper sticker, but, you know, be kind to everyone you meet. They're all fighting a battle.
Yeah.
So look, there's no one. I mean, we're all of a certain age. We know this now, but you know, there's no one who doesn't have some problem in their lives, if it's physical problems or emotional or family problems or financial. And, you know, I think when you see people in that light, you know, it doesn't excuse what they do if they're really mean or wicked, but it does put them in a different light.
Yeah. We have a message in from Lee who says, one of the great things I found in praying with the Psalms is the power of their maledictions, but then the turn toward God again at the end. It feels great to utter those maledictions, thousands of years old, but remarkably current, so long as you get to the end and make the turn. I think the maledictions have a place, but only if you turn.
What a great insight. You know, I'm thinking of Psalm 139, which starts out so beautifully, God, you search me and you know me, that you know when I stand and when I sit down. And then suddenly, oh God, how I hate my enemies, and would you do this to them? And but then at the end, as Lee was saying, it kind of turns. Look, I think they're very human. One of the great things about the Psalms is that they're very human. Mm-hmm. And they lament and they shake their fist at God and they ask God to, you know, turn the ankles of our enemies. It's very human, but it is always founded on God. I do think there's one, I'll tell you a funny story. I think I put this in the book, that there's a Psalm that says, you know, that you may dash the babies of my enemies on the rocks.
Yeah.
And I remember asking all these different scripture scholars, and one said, well, you know, we could look at it. I think Augustine does this. We could look at it as kind of the parts of us that are sinful, right? Can we let those parts of us go? That's the first thing. Second, we can look at it as, you know, the other thing is that they may have literally meant that.
Right.
You know, we're dealing with an ancient culture where they actually meant, this is what you should do to the babies of my friends. Now, I often say to people, you know, you do not need to pray in the same way that the ancient people did in the Old Testament. And hopefully we're not praying that anyone's babies are being done anything to. But I think so using the Psalms in a way to kind of express our emotions, our deep emotions, but also kind of looking at them in their historical context is important too.
Sister Lois, who's a member of the community, and she's on the staff of the center, and she's also the director of hospitality for the monastery.
Wonderful.
Yeah, and one of our spiritual directors. She says, would you speak to how our image of who God is affects our desire to pray or not?
That's a great question. I was thinking, boy, in charge of hospitality for a Benedictine community, that's like, she must be the most hospitable person in the world.
Yes.
So, by the way, that's another thing Jesuits could learn from the Benedictines. You know, hospice venit, Christus venit, the guest comes, Christ comes. There's an old, well, I'm not going to, I'll say it. It's a Jesuit joke because Jesuits are not often known for their hospitality, you know? And so the old joke in the Jesuits is our motto should be the guest comes, Christ comes, he is crucified. So we really do need to learn. I've been to Benedictine monasteries and it's like, oh my gosh, I can't believe how welcome I feel. Like, well, it's part of our charism. Yeah, so the question of our image of God, I think, is really an important one because if we have an image of God, for example, that many of us do, that's very judgmental, or as a friend of mine says, transactional. Like if I do this, God will do this. One of my favorite images was from a friend of mine who said she sees God, I mean, this is really powerful, as the parole officer. So not only the judge, but you've already done something terrible. Where do these images come from? A lot of them come from our family of origin, right? If we've had parents who have been another great, I hear at least from friends, withholding of love, conditional love, right? Or even unfortunately like abusive, then when someone says, you know, pray to God, the Father or God, the Mother, we don't want any part of that, right? And so we often have to challenge our images of God. And one of the things that I find them, I was just talking about this with someone just last night. One of the things I think is the most helpful is to look at our experiences of God. I literally was just talking about this to someone last night. So we might have an image of God, for example, and this may be what Sister was referring to, like a judgmental God. Everyone thinks of God the judge or God the critic or God the parole officer, or God the whatever, the conditional person. And yet people have experiences of God, as you both know, for example, in prayer on retreat where they feel this sense of calm. Or they feel quiet, or they feel peace, or just this person last night said they felt a sense of joy. And I often say, all right, well, that's God. That's your experience of God. That's not your image of God, right? And so I always say let's say I was directing Dawn, and Dawn came to me and said, I have this image of God, and yet I had this experience of God. So I said, you have to look at Dawn's God in her mind versus God. And sometimes what we have to do is actually get rid of what I think are kind of idols in our head and actually smash them. I mean, not actually, but get rid of them in order to experience the real God. Because most of us will say, well, you know, the first commandment, I'm the Lord your God, you will have no idols. People on this call would say, well, I don't have idols. I don't have some little, you know, metal thing that I worship and I don't worship, you know, like graven images. But in a sense, many of us do have idols of God in our mind that we have kind of built up thanks to things that we've learned from our family or even religious leaders that have maybe kind of, you know, messed us up a little bit that prevent us, as Sister was saying, from really encountering God. And those idols have to be smashed. And what we have to do is we have to encounter the living God, the God who wants to be encountered and say, all right, that's God. So like, for example, I was just saying to this person last night, for this person, God was this sense of calm. And I said, well, that's the quality of God. And so recognize that and not some weird image of the judgmental, angry God that's like beating you over the head, you know? So get rid of those images sometimes. We have to challenge them.
Mm-hmm. Hey, maybe that's what the psalm means for us to smash, those idols.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, can we use that as an image of smashing those things, yeah, and getting rid of them. It's hard. I mean, I find I still look a little sharing. I'm 61 years old. I've been a Jesuit for 33 years. I still fall into the transactional God. If I am good, God will reward me. I just, it's just ingrained in me. And I have to remind myself, that's not who God is. It's not the way God works.
Yeah, we have a message in from Zeb who says, I'm an Episcopal priest, so I use a lot of rote prayer mixed with scripture. I find that sometimes people in my congregation think prayer is best done from the Book of Common Prayer, which is a beautiful book of prayer, and are afraid to pray without elegant language. How do you help people work through stuttering and being unsure in what to say when praying?
Well, I think that some of that does have to do with our image of God. And I mean, I think the Book of Common Prayer, I agree, Dawn, is beautiful and certainly something that, you know, people rely on and something that people find great meaning in and something that helps people. And it's also the sense of kind of history and community. So I don't want to denigrate that. But if you have an image of God as God who only will listen to those kinds of prayers, and, you know, St. Ignatius says in the spiritual exercises, another tradition is we are invited to speak to God as one friend speaks to another. I think maybe the best antidote to that is to ask people about their images of God, right? And maybe this God who's very kind of high up and almost like the Monty Python, you know, oh God, you are so big, you are so great, and we are so little, and I put that in the book. To ask about their images of God, to also look at how Jesus talks to people. Because Jesus speaks to people in very everyday language. He talks to, you know, mustard seeds and weeds and wheat and, you know, a woman who lost a coin. And it's very simple and down to earth. And I sometimes say, can you talk to God the way that the disciples talk to Jesus? I mean, you know, they're not always, sometimes they are in awe, you know, who is this then that the wind and waves obey him? Sometimes they're kneeling in front of him. But a lot of times, you know, like look at Martha and Mary, one of my favorite stories in Luke. You know, Martha and Mary are hosting Jesus at their house. And by the way, as an aside, it doesn't say meal, interestingly. There's nothing in there about a meal. Martha is doing diaconia. She's doing ministry or service, which I didn't realize until recently. Anyway, they're hosting Jesus. And Martha is upset that Mary is not doing more diaconia, more ministry, more work. And she says to Jesus, first of all, don't you care that I'm doing all the work? And one of my favorite lines in scripture, tell her to help me. I mean, that's a quote. That is really strong. And so if Martha can talk to Jesus like that, can we talk to God just in sort of everyday language? By the way, before I forget, I don't want to wrap up talking about Martha and Mary and diaconia. I do want to encourage people on this call, if you can, to contribute to this wonderful organization. I know this is going to sound, well, I wanted to say it.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I think that this ministry is just so wonderful. They're doing such great work. You can see the wisdom here and the Benedictine tradition. And I just want to encourage anyone, especially if there's any millionaires out there or thousandaires out there who can make a contribution, I think it would be really, it's a wonderful apostolate and ministry. So just, I just was thinking about that in terms of Martha and Mary. You know, being blunt with people. So
thank you. Sure. Yeah.
Wow.
We have from Barbara, she says, what is your experience with praying with other cultures? With a multifaceted Jesus, in what ways can prayer help cross differences and create difference? And how do you understand cultural bias toward prayer? And
oh my gosh, that's like a book.
Yeah.
I don't know that I can answer all that. Is it, what was the name of the woman?
Barbara.
Thank you, Barbara. That's a great question. I mean, I would say that's a really provocative one too, because it, you know, how does it sort of help to unite us, but also sometimes divide us? I spent 2 years in East Africa, in Kenya. Mm-hmm. And so I saw different ways of praying that were very, you know, just different liturgical styles, I think, is what comes to mind. I also think what comes to mind are different images of Jesus and different images of God. And, you know, Jesus, interestingly, in John, it sounds like a digression. It doesn't say the word became a man. It doesn't say the word became a human. It says the word became flesh. Mm-hmm. The word becomes matter, almost becomes part of creation. And so it's less important that Jesus was a man, right? But we do have to understand he becomes human. He's incarnated. And so when I look at images of Jesus that are unusual and in different colors of skin, and images of God that are, I mean, you know, God is beyond all imagery, right?
Right.
It can be really, it can be inviting, it can be inspiring, it can be threatening to people. You know, oftentimes I put things on social media, different ways of looking at Jesus, a homeless Jesus or a refugee, Holy Family. It really shocks people and they say, oh, you're being political. But that's part of the challenging aspect of, well, I think it's we need to be challenged to see God as always bigger, semper maior, right? Always bigger. Mm-hmm. So I would say by looking at different cultures, we are able to expand our ways of praying. Mm-hmm. And it sometimes can be, we have to, you know, sometimes it kind of comes up against stuff and it can challenge us. But in general, I think that if it helps us to see God in a new way, all the better. One of my favorite quotes, I put it in the book, I put it in almost every book. I read it in the novitiate. It's from a Jesuit named Carlos Valles. I think I can quote it. If you always imagine God in the same way, then you will never be open to the new ways that God has a revealing of God's self to you. Mm. And I mean, I'll use one example. One of my favorite books is She Who Is,
yes,
by Elizabeth Johnson. I'm sure a lot of you know her, not a Benedictine, a CSJ. Mm. And it's something like, it's about feminine imagery of God. And I'm not talking about Mary, right? I'm talking about imagery of God that is feminine in the Old Testament, in particular, wisdom, Ruah, and it really helped me. And when you use words like, when one uses words like, you know, God, her, people just go crazy. Mm-hmm. And I have to remind them, and it's funny, like on social media, this is a digression, you know, God, Jesus called God the Father, but you know, God is not male.
Right.
You know, and it's threat. Just even saying that is threatening to people, and it shouldn't be, right? And so Beth Johnson's book is a one way of kind of opening ourselves up to that. And that's in a sense is a different culture.
Yeah.
Right? Than the culture that we're used to, if that makes sense, right?
It does. Yeah.
So yeah, it's God. And you know, when we get to heaven, whenever that is, I think God's going to be beyond all of our categories. As Augustine said, if you can define it, it is not God.
Yeah. You know, I believe Kevin has a question for you. You mentioned social media a second ago. This might be a good time for.
Yeah, I would hate to take a question away from a viewer, but I'm just kind of curious, you know, Father Jim, you're so well familiar with social media and communication technologies, given what you do and your work. I was just wondering, like, you know, so many of us are on our phones today. We got computers, laptops, tablets, all that kind of stuff. Does technology have a place in the life of prayer?
Yeah, I would say it's a two-edged sword, right? I mean, on the one hand, I'll take the positive. On the one hand, we're doing this. This is technology. We're meeting people. We're meeting 83 people to talk about prayer in the Benedictine and Jesuit tradition, and it's beautiful. Mm-hmm. And this is technology. This would not, if God forbid, if there were COVID and no one had any computers, oh my gosh, you know, we really feel isolated. It can connect us. I use a lot of social media like Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, now TikTok a little bit, to sort of, you know, I posted an image of a brand new icon that was done and a meditation. And I think that people can really find God there. And look, this is going where people are. I often say, one of the things I like to say is that when Jesus, you know, we always hear God meets you where you are, which is true. Meaning, you know, God encounters you in the kind of the stuff of your life. But Jesus went to people where people were in two ways. He literally went to where they were, going from Nazareth to the Sea of Galilee. He went to see the first disciples. But when he was there, he spoke in their language. He doesn't use carpentry language and say, let us build the reign of God. He says, I will make you fishers of people. So social media is, and devices going to where they are and speaking their language. Now, that's the good part. The bad part, as you know, is that it's distracting. And a lot of people, including a lot of young people, nothing to be ageist, but, you know, they cannot disconnect. And I think at some point you do have to disconnect in order to, not to say you can't encounter God through social media or through watching something on YouTube or whatever, but at some point there is that need for that one-on-one quiet time. And I think we are kind of losing that. I'm sure Dawn in particular has this experience as a retreat director. When I started out going on retreats 30 years ago, the only way, it sounds like ancient history, the only way that someone could get in touch with you was to leave a message at the retreat house and they'd take a little pink slip. Maybe you get it the next day. right? Or that people would write you a letter. And this is within recent memory. Now, boy, you have to beg people. Not beg them almost. And they still do it. They can't do it. And so I think that's the drawback. You know, it's a blessing and a curse, I think.
Yeah.
So I think it's kind of a wash, actually.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for that.
Yeah. You know, I'm aware that we're at time, but I do have one question that we have to ask because it's the focus of your last chapter, and a number of questions have come in asking, various things about this topic, and that's the relationship of prayer to justice. Mm. You know, to keep our prayer from being an inward focus. And it's kind of like, you know, we go to church and what happens when we walk out the door? So you are very active in the realm of justice with your advocacy for marginalized populations, with the way that you call the church to task when we're making mistakes in the church, and the way that you just handle your Facebook page, for instance, with reminding people, these are the rules here, and we're going to treat each other this way. And so I've been, I watch you do this. And so I'm wondering what thoughts you have about prayer and justice and our call.
What a great question. I think that generally speaking, you know, we get moved to do things. You know, one of my favorite Greek words, I don't speak ancient Greek, but I know a little, is when Jesus is moved with pity. The word is esplagnizomai, which is a kind of, it's his guts. He's like, feels it in his guts. And so Jesus is moved when he sees people who are struggling. This was just the gospel reading a couple days ago, like sheep without a shepherd. And I think we feel like that when we see, you know, if we see someone being hurt, or just even something simple, not simple, but, you know, something as basic as like wildfires or tornadoes, you watch those pictures and there's a part of you that feels sad. In terms of justice, when we see people being treated unjustly, right? And the poor, migrants and refugees, all sorts of, you know, homeless, right? We feel this sense of kind of almost righteous indignation. And I think when we pray about that, if we can see it as one way that God has of working through us and moving us, you know, I mean, how else would God move us other than to kind of awaken in us this sense of injustice? And I think often prayer does that. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're praying about, you know, Jesus feeding a crowd, and suddenly you have this image of some homeless person you passed, you know, this thing, well, what is going on and why is this coming up? Or if you simply see something on social media or on TV or in the newspapers about refugees, and you just say, or migrants, and you say, oh my gosh, I feel so angry about that. This is God moving us. And I think that's one of the results of prayer, which is to get us to act.
Right.
You know, and it's uncomfortable at times, but, and also, or even just, you know, Dawn, I mean, we're talking about a kind of, it's like these larger issues, but even, you know, having, if you've wronged somebody and your conscience bothers you, I mean, that's justice too. And just apologize, right? So we have to, I think one of the things about this phone is that it prevents us from sometimes really doing that deep inner work. I mean, if you're constantly being distracted, and, you know, I was talking to a young person recently who will remain nameless, and I was like, well, what do you, and was at a family gathering, and I was like, what are you actually looking at? And he was like, nothing, just looking at like tweets and memes. And so it was nothing important. It was just to kind of occupy him. And that kind of distraction, I think, can sort of insulate us from our conscience and from things that are coming up, because it's very painful sometimes to say, what am I called to do? But this is the call of prayer. And this is, you know, this is what God asks of us in our prayer, but we need to be open to listening to it.
I wonder if it's almost become a bit of a, kind of a coping mechanism, you know, almost. Yeah. Have you found your prayer over the last 2 years? One of the things, and we don't obviously have time to go into it, but we were wondering about the role of lament in prayer. And the last 2 years have held a lot of that for every one of us. And I was curious if your prayer has changed in the last couple of years.
Yeah, it's been a lot. Well, it's been longer, obviously. I mean, I say obviously, but at the beginning of the pandemic, one Jesuit in our community said, I mean, the very beginning, remember when no one was going in anywhere, there wasn't a whole lot of Zoom, and we didn't really mm-hmm. understand what's going on. People were just like quarantined. Mm-hmm. He said, well, you know, guys, we're always saying we wish we had more time to pray, and now we do.
Yeah.
And so it's been a little longer. I think one of the there has been a lot of more begging and asking. Mm-hmm. There's also a lot of more gratitude when I think about how, you know, worse off so many people are. I'll tell you one thing that I found really helpful, though, and we'll talk about this. This will bring it back to the monastic life. One of the most helpful things for me, though, in just dealing with COVID and dealing with this new reality, which hopefully we'll get back soon, hopefully in a couple of months, we hope, is that I remember thinking, oh my gosh, I'm not going to work. This is my little room, my Jesuit room. Am I going to go crazy? And I realized, which, you know, the sisters will smile. I realized, well, you know what? Monks do this. They've done this for hundreds of years. And I think, you know, Kevin was talking about finding God in the ordinary as part of the Benedictine spirituality. And I think that was really liberating for me to know that people have done this. People have lived in cells and sometimes not going out of the monastery. And now, I mean, they're generally in nicer settings than I look out into an alley. But I think that there's great wisdom there. And I think the monastic life can teach us a lot about finding God in the ordinary, finding God in the everyday. So that's COVID has changed that for me in that way too.
Yeah. Well, thank you. I want to just take a minute to thank everyone for being with us on this call tonight. And I do apologize for those of you whose questions didn't get answered. I may send them on to Father Jim, and if he has any words of wisdom, he can send them my way and I'll pass them on. Kevin, thank you for being here with us. It was a joy to work with you again, and looking forward to more of that in the future. And I think you have an announcement for the participants, Kevin.
I do. An exciting giveaway. We have 50 copies of Father Jim's book, which is published under James Martin, if you're looking him up. So we've got 50 copies to give away for the first 50 people, registrants for this Zoom call. First 50 people to come to the reception desk at the monastery. Okay. So, and I think we've given you a 2-week deadline.
Yes.
So within the next 2 weeks. Okay. So free copy of this Father James Martin's new book.
And just so you know, anyone can walk in there to get a book. Just bring a mask, and the reception desk is right inside the door. Sister Lois will be managing those books, so we're glad to get those into your hands. So I'll send out a reminder email about this in the morning to everyone on the call, and then I'll probably remind you a few days down the road to be sure and get in there. And thank you for the Bregelman program for getting those books, Kevin. That was very generous. Thank you.
My pleasure.
So, Father Jim, thank you so much again, and for the lovely book, for all your writing, and all your work and all your devotion and dedication. This has truly been wonderful. And I want to give an opportunity to you to come back and see what kind of words you'd like to leave us with tonight.
Yeah, thank you. First of all, thank you, Dawn. Thank you, Kevin, so much. Jean was on earlier. I want to thank her as well. And thank everybody for spending time. I just want to say I'm very grateful for joining you. To always trust that the desire you have for God is God's desire for you. And that'll help start you off under the life of prayer. Please keep me in your prayers. I'd also ask you, there's someone in my family who's dealing with a medical thing, so I'd ask you for prayers for that person. And Dawn, if it's okay, can we end with a prayer?
Please.
All right, great. So let's pray in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Loving God, we thank you for bringing us together tonight. We thank you for the gift of prayer in our lives. As we try to become more and more people of prayer, help us to open our hearts to the various ways that you are with us. And we ask this through the intercession of Saint Benedict and Saint Scholastica, and in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And on behalf of the sisters, on behalf of the Sisters of Saint Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, to everyone with us tonight, blessings of peace, hope, and joy to you and your loved ones. Thank you all.
Thank you so much. God bless you. Thanks so much, guys.
Thank you.